Welcome. I'm Bob Vasteen, Senior Industry Fellow at the Georgetown Center for Business and Public Policy. And welcome today to this session of our series called Georgetown on the Hill, which we have been focusing on trade policy. This may be the eighth or the ninth in this set of discussions. The center is a nonpartisan academic research center that engages policymakers, scholars, business people, and all you guys who have not, maybe not included in those baskets, in discussions and research bearing on important current policy issues. Today's session focuses on our exceptionally important relationship, trade and investment relationship with China. China's accession to the WTO in 2001 was a milestone in the ambitious effort to liberalize China's economy begun by Deng Xiaoping. Since that bold step, China has experienced a period of exceptional growth, but in spite of its burgeoning trade and increasingly important stake in the global trading system, China has proved very reluctant to open its markets further in trade negotiations in Doha, in the Doha round, and in other forums, yielding to powerful vested interests, including its enormous state-owned enterprises. Recently, however, there have been indicators that China may have turned the corner. Its leadership may be adopting a sincerely more progressive stance on some key issues of our commercial interest. So this excellent panel will survey the state of play in the complex U.S.-China relationship. Our moderator is Professor Brad Jensen, Professor of International Business and Economics, and a senior scholar at the center. Brad will introduce the panel and moderate the discussion. Brad.
Thanks, Bob. So welcome. We're delighted you're here. Looking forward to just terrific panel discussion. I will introduce the panelists now and then let them make 7 or 8 minutes of comments, and then we'll open it up to Q&A. And we'll go to 1:15, 1:30, depending on people's appetite. So to my left, to your right, is Claire Reade, who is Assistant United States Trade Representative for China Affairs in the Office of the U.S. Trade Representative. To her left is Daniel Bahar, Deputy Assistant U.S. Trade Representative for Investment. To his left is Erin Ennis, who is Vice President of the U.S.-China Business Council. And to her left is Professor Doug Guthrie, who's Professor of International Business at George Washington University and a specialist on China. He has several books on China. So an excellent panel, and I won't take any more airtime and turn it over to Claire.
Thank you, Brad. It's on. There, that works better. Thanks very much. Thanks, everyone, for being here. Thanks to Georgetown for pulling this group together. I am definitely honored to be sitting next to my my colleague, Mr. Bahar, who is a whiz at all things investment. And Ms. Ennis is no slouch when it comes to China issues in terms of the on-the-ground concerns that businesses have with China. And of course, it's always a pleasure to have someone who really has a chance to study and contemplate China, as opposed to the problems that we sometimes say we have in USTR, where the rap sometimes is that we struggle to ensure that the urgent doesn't overtake the important. You can contemplate that thought. but in any event, I'm just back from China as part of the administration's overall efforts with China, which are, how do I put this? They include two very important bilateral mechanisms that we use in addition to the opportunities that we have to meet in multilateral meetings or in bilateral meetings with Chinese leaders. And these are the strategic and economic dialogue, and for our side of the house, which is focused on economic issues, of course, the economic track and specifically the trade and investment track of the strategic and economic dialogue. And then the Joint Commission on Commerce and Trade, affectionately known as the JCCT, which is a year-long process that culminates in a plenary meeting at a very high level with two of our cabinet members, the Secretary of Commerce and the USTR, co-chairing on our side, and a very eminent vice premier from China co-chairing on the other side. We also are fortunate to have our agriculture secretary participate in the JCCT on agricultural trade issues. So those are the two big bilateral institutional mechanisms, if you will, that we use to try to move forward on our China policy and to work with and obviously encourage and sometimes push China to move in directions that we think are good for, frankly, for them, for the United States, and for the global trading system. So The JCCT, which is what we're in the middle of now because we completed the S&ED for this year in July, the JCCT picks up on the themes that we obviously think are priorities for the country and that were covered, obviously, therefore, in the S&ED, and we try to move them forward. So topics that are of concern to us include government procurement, intellectual property protection, China's state-owned enterprises, China's initiatives to try to drive strategic emerging sectors and what their policies are in terms of promoting those sectors, ensuring there's no discrimination from our perspective, market access issues for agriculture, for our products and services, as well as investment issues and problems inside China's industrial policies from our perspective that are creating barriers for U.S. Interests who are trying to export to China and operate in China and basically create a level playing field for them. We had our mid-year review of the JCCT last year in Beijing. That mid-year review involved both reviewing the commitments that had been made by China in the 2012 JCCT and ensuring that we were moving forward on full implementation of those commitments, as well as teeing up the kinds of issues that we're interested in pursuing in 2013. And I just reviewed what those themes are. The effort will continue anchored by the working groups that the JCCT has. There's 16 or 17 working groups that are very active. There's one, for example, on MedFarm that's going on in Beijing right now. There will be more of those through the fall. They will be active through face-to-face meetings as well as DVCs, digital video conferences, to try to move forward on our issues. Other folks who were in China with us last week included people working on government procurement issues and a lot of work on intellectual property issues. And we also had meetings regarding state-owned enterprises and where China is in its reform efforts. Now, our efforts are designed to try to take advantage of and to push forward on the directions that China's already taking regarding reform. Bob made the very good point that China has now seemed to turn back from a retrenchment phase that it had been in following its accession to the WTO. So there was an implementation of WTO commitments that occurred in China that was a focus, and there was a great recognition in China that they really needed to do the right thing in terms of their WTO commitments in order for China itself to develop economically. I think there then became kind of, I don't know, international outside orientation fatigue in China, and there was a major retrenchment in terms of attitudes and the approach that was being taken as the dominant narrative that we were hearing from the outside. So a lot of resistance to doing more liberalization, a lot of resistance to change and to really thinking beyond the actual specifics of the WTO commitment to what other kinds of changes would be good for China in terms of really creating a market economy. We think with the new leadership, the dialogue has now changed and shifted. It's not as if the other undercurrent isn't still there, but there now are folks who are looking at China's self-interest and understanding that they could get caught in terms of their economic development. There really could be stagnation. There are a lot of difficulties that they have economically that won't get solved unless they look at much greater liberalization, and that they're going to have to think about opening, they're going to have to think about reforming their state-owned enterprise systems. There's going to be a lot that they're really going to have to be doing. And we're hopeful that we can use the recognition to spur them in the areas that are really creating problems for our stakeholders, and there are lots of them. So we are very active and very candid with China in trying to move things forward, and we're hopeful that this year we will see some important steps forward by China in areas that are obviously good for them in our view and are obviously good for us. And one area of great importance where we have short-term issues where we really do want to make progress is investment restrictions. But in addition to our trying to make short-term progress on investment restrictions, including this very vaunted Shanghai Free Trade Zone that we still don't know what it's going to do, we are also very interested, obviously, in moving forward with the BIT. And I think that may be a good segue to Daniel.
Great. Thank you, Claire.
Thank you, Claire. And let me join Claire in thanking the Georgetown Center, thanking Bob, expressing my appreciation for the opportunity to serve on a distinguished panel with colleagues and friends. And also, let me thank all of you for taking what I assume is your lunch hour to come and meet with us and hear our thoughts on these issues. I will spend my opening remarks focused on one initiative that Claire just mentioned, the ongoing U.S.-China bilateral investment treaty negotiation that has been ongoing since 2008, but on which there have been some interesting developments in the last 3 or 4 months. Briefly, before getting into detail, what is a bilateral investment treaty? Just to start with the basics. A bilateral investment treaty is a treaty that two or more countries can enter that seeks, on the one hand, to obtain agreement between the countries that when investors of one country are in the territory of the other country, they will agree to meet certain standards of treatment. They will agree, for example, not to discriminate against foreign investors, to meet minimum international law standards with respect to the treatment of investors, not to expropriate without fair, effective, adequate compensation for investors. Importantly, in markets like the China market, countries also, under agreements like ours, need to commit not to impose so-called performance requirements, like requirements to use local content or local technology or transfer technology to the government of the host state or to domestic folks within that country. So substantive rules is one piece of what bilateral investment treaties do. The second piece is that they provide a very significant mechanism for enforcement. Specifically, these types of treaties provide what's known as investor-state arbitration or dispute settlement, which permits an investor of one country, if there is a view that the country in which they have invested has breached the legal treaty obligations that that country has entered into, they have the ability to pursue international arbitration in order to obtain monetary damages in the event that a ad hoc panel finds that there was a breach. And the United States, we have 40 bilateral investment treaties in force. We have treaties with countries around the world. We also seek to negotiate these types of commitments as chapters in each of our trade agreements. Importantly, from the U.S. perspective, as a general matter, what we seek to do in our investment treaties and in the investment chapters of trade agreements is to create a certain balance. Of course, our goal is to ensure that we negotiate meaningful, significant protections on behalf of our investors. It's also important to make sure that the rules that we negotiate are balanced, include appropriate safeguards, ensure that governments fully retain the right to regulate in the public interest, including in areas like safety, the environment, and public health. And on the arbitration side as well, we include a number of innovative safeguards to ensure that the arbitration process is fair and can't be abused, and particularly important, is transparent. All of the types of arbitrations that can be conducted under U.S. agreements are open to the public, All the documents that are filed in these types of cases are available to the public. That's a little bit of background on what bilateral investment treaties are. Within the U.S. government, the U.S. Trade Representative's Office shares responsibility for the bilateral investment treaty program with our colleagues at the State Department. And so our two agencies, USTR and State, since 2008 have been pursuing this discussion with China about the possibility of negotiating a bilateral investment treaty. The discussions have been interesting and productive on both sides, but from the beginning there were certain differences in approach that we thought could potentially be the most significant obstacles, and that's what I'll focus on for the remainder of these comments. If one were to look at the publicly available U.S. model bilateral investment treaty and compare it to the publicly available agreements that China has entered into, their BITs and their FTA investment chapters in, let's say, the last 10 years, which represent their most recent approach in that area, you would see on the one hand a number of similarities on key issues, but you would also see some key differences. And up until the present time, the biggest differences that you might observe if you compared those public documents would be with respect to the so-called non-discrimination rules. You would see that U.S. treaties always include non-discrimination rules that are comprehensive, that protect investors at all phases of investment, including, importantly, the market access phase when investors are seeking to invest. And we also make sure that there are very few exceptions to those types of rules, and any exceptions that are included are negotiated exceptions on a so-called negative list basis. And that jargon basically means that everything's covered by the agreement, every measure, every sector. And if you want an exception, you have to explicitly negotiate it, and then that exception is included in a transparent manner in an annex in the back of the treaty. And so those are two key elements to the U.S. approach. To date, China has entered into more than 100 investment treaties and trade agreement investment commitments, and they had never agreed to either of those two key elements. And given that many of the key aspects of China's approach to the regulation of foreign investment to date have been discriminatory. Foreign investors are prohibited from investing in many sectors, and even where they can invest, there are often very significant requirements on how they can do so. And the investment approval process in China differs with respect to foreign investors when compared to domestic investors. There were many issues that one could point to that could be viewed as reasons why China had taken the approach that it had to date. The significant development that I can share with you is in the context of the cabinet-level strategic and economic dialogue meeting in July that Claire had referenced earlier. There was a significant public joint commitment in which China and the United States agreed that our two governments going forward will negotiate our bilateral investment treaty on the basis of an approach to non-discrimination that includes market access, and that is negotiated on this so-called negative list approach where all exceptions have to be explicitly negotiated. It's a very significant move for China to have made the decision to change its approach. If you look at the public statements that Chinese officials made in their press, they cited multiple reasons for adopting what they have referred to in their press as a leading global approach with respect to investment commitments. They cited both the interests of outbound Chinese investors, but also the idea that these significant decisions are consistent with current views about potential future domestic economic reform as major motivating factors for these significant decisions. The decisions and the new commitments that were made were cited by U.S. Trade Representative Froman as critical elements that will allow us to move forward in our negotiation. They were cited by Secretary of Treasury Liu as a significant breakthrough in the negotiation. And so we look forward now to engaging more intensively with China on the basis of this agreement on these key elements. The last point that I would note is, well, we have made significant progress in recent months. I think on both sides, we've always been well aware that this will be a very challenging negotiation. I don't think there are illusions on either side that this will be very tough, that there are going to be difficult issues on the table. And so we're still early in the talks, but we're pleased to be able to report at this stage that we've made some significant progress.
Thanks, Daniel.
I think that's my cue. I'm Erin Ennis from the U.S.-China Business Council. I will align myself with the thanks that everyone has already said, and also thank, I see a lot of friendly faces in the audience, so thank you for coming out and listening to us. My task is to tell you a little bit about what the business community's view is of what's going on in China and what their top issues are. So I'm going to restrict my remarks to that. And if there's any of these that anyone would like to chat more about, I'm happy to go into a little more detail. So right now, I would say the biggest focus for most U.S. companies in their operations with China is the economic reforms that Claire mentioned that the leadership is undertaking. This is a new leadership, so we're still trying to figure out exactly where their primary interests are, how far they will be willing to go. And frankly, so far, we're getting mixed messages. On the one hand, we're hearing very positive things about things like the Shanghai Free Trade Zone that the Chinese have announced will be driving market openings and reforms in China. On the other hand, there is a lot of news about pricing investigations that are going on, primarily of foreign companies in China, as well as some backlash that foreign IT companies are experiencing in China. The takeaway from all of this from us at this point, based on the council's meetings in Beijing, has been that when it comes right down to it, there is still an active debate going on within China's government about what the direction will be of economic reforms. And to date, it is still to be determined whether all of the problems that foreign companies are experiencing are going to be addressed, but also what the scope and the pace of those reforms will be even for Chinese companies. For instance, there's very little clarity right now on whether there will be any reductions in foreign ownership restrictions in China, despite the fact that China is now agreeing to a bilateral investment treaty that should theoretically be reducing the ownership restrictions, as well as the fact that China is pursuing pretty active reduction in licensing requirements. But to date, really very few of those reductions have affected industries that foreign companies are dealing with in China. So when it comes down to it, I think what we are trying to evaluate right now is whether China will engage in reforms and openings of its economy, or they will really be engaging in reforms but without those kinds of openings for foreign companies. There is a plenum of the Chinese Communist Party in November, and there's a lot of high expectations, I think, going into that. And I think the council's caution on that would be don't expect too much out of it. If the information that we are hearing right now is accurate, that this internal debate is still very active within China, it's probably more likely that we will see incremental changes coming out of the November plenum rather than major changes. Certainly it would be nice to see major changes, but I think more realistically we should expect probably an incremental approach, unless one side actually takes an upper hand in this debate. In terms of the top issues that U.S. companies are experiencing in China, I would say at the top of the list is what Daniel just hit on, investment restrictions. When it comes right down to it, investment restrictions are market access restrictions for foreign companies. And that's why things like a bilateral investment treaty are as important as they are. It means the difference between whether a foreign company can open and operate in China on the same basis that their domestic competitors can. Right now, China maintains restrictions in at least 100 areas. Those range in almost every sector that you can imagine, from agriculture to auto manufacturing to chemicals and energy production. Ideally, what we hope to see is that the Chinese move to eliminate every one of those restrictions as a part of Daniel's valiant negotiating efforts. Realistically, that's probably going to take some time. For our purpose, however, we think it's important that whatever China does, either with its eye on the bilateral investment treaty negotiations or with its eye on its own economic reforms, they need to begin implementing those changes now to benefit foreign companies. As most everyone in this room knows, a bilateral investment treaty has to be approved by the Senate. And I think it will be a very difficult sell if the outcome of the negotiations is that is an aspirational list of the openings that will happen sometime after a treaty is put into force. I think it will be a much more useful and fruitful discussion with the Senate over the approval of this agreement if China starts implementing those reforms now, and foreign companies and the senators who will be voting on this have an opportunity to see that China is implementing those changes now to reinforce their sincerity at pursuing these kinds of reforms. I think the other key point here is to keep in mind what outcome China is moving towards. Right now, foreign companies, when they operate in China, depending on the structure they get, but in general, they are always treated as a foreign invested enterprise within the market. So even if you were able to be treated as on an equal basis with a domestic company, the designation in within China still makes a distinction between foreign and domestic companies. By contrast, in general in the United States, once a foreign company has invested here, they are treated for all other purposes under U.S. law just like any other company, be they an American company or otherwise. That, frankly, should be where China should be moving on this. It's a modern economy. It wants to have the kinds of growth on a sustained basis throughout its economy that the United States has and other major economies. And as a consequence, that kind of a change is really where they should be looking. Another key focus, which foreign companies have in China, is intellectual property rights protection. I think probably everyone in the room is familiar with the nature of those challenges, but it's not just a matter of whether movies and DVDs are ripped off. It's whether patents are protected and how you enforce your rights. It's whether trademarks are protected, trade secrets, which is still a very emerging area in China's policy, particularly in its judicial enforcement of what those rights might be. That one, too, is an evolving nature and an evolving issue. And so our companies are watching very closely and pushing China in a direction that will create the kind of protections that will give investors confidence that when they invest in China, that not only will their intellectual property rights be protected, but if a problem occurs, that they have recourse to be able to get compensation for what they've lost. The final topic that I'll touch on is one that actually relates to IP issues, and that's China's innovation policy. For obvious reasons that I think everyone can support, China is trying to move its economy away from being the assembler of products in the world and move itself up the value-added chain, and they want to become a source of innovation in the world. Right now, their primary approach of doing that has been using incentives to promote innovation that have been linked either to where intellectual property rights are registered in the world or an incentive that is linked to government procurement access. Both of those are problematic for foreign companies. On the first hand, companies do innovation throughout the world, not based on what an investment policy might do, but frankly based on what their global needs are. And so one company might have patents registered in three different countries, but do production of a final product and be in doing innovative things in an economy in China or in Korea or the United States or elsewhere. I think we can argue pretty confidently that the U.S. has one of the most innovative economies in the world, and the approach that most innovative countries use on this front is not to have those kinds of IP-linked requirements, but instead reward companies for doing innovative things within their borders, and that's where really China should be moving. In some ways, China is moving away from these policies. Thanks to the hard work of USTR and others, China has backed away from a policy that it started in 2009 that required not only locally registered IP, but also then provided government procurement benefits for companies to get innovative incentives. Not only was that a policy announced at the central government level, but then the State Council of China's government required all the provinces to implement as well. And we've seen most of the provinces implement it. But unfortunately, it hasn't been 100%, so there's still work to be done there. And equally unfortunately, we have seen similar ties to IP ownership requirements in some of the new policies China's putting out for the development of what they refer to as strategic emerging industries. They are areas where China is seeking aspirationally to develop its economy in the future. Those kinds of linkages, I think, are counterproductive, particularly for China's overall goal of developing an innovative economy. And so what our goal is, and what we've been encouraging the U.S. government to do, is to push China towards the kinds of tax incentives that are not based on either what the country, what a company's nationality is, or where their IP is registered, and instead base it on the fact that you want to encourage innovative activities. And with that, I will stop.
Thank you. Thank you all for having me. I'm going to basically agree with what a lot of what's been said here, but also just try to, I guess, take the academic standpoint and give a little bit of historical context, because I actually think it's really important for understanding where our relationship with China is and what where it actually is going to be going. So just about myself, I've spent, you know, most of my adult life as a China scholar and have gone from language and literature through the social sciences to being a business school professor and then dean. And it's given me an opportunity to both study China a lot, but also advise a lot of companies in thinking about China. And what I see is very much a, we are at a critical juncture at this very moment, and I agree with what everybody has said, that we actually don't know where it's going to go, because we don't know really the direction of the new leadership and whether or not they're actually going to be able to contain what's happening. Now, as just as part of this historical background, I have to say, I have been long been very, very bullish on China. In the 90s, I sort of built a career on arguing with Jeffrey Sachs over whether this was a house of cards or whether or not we needed to be paying attention and really listening. And I was always on the side of paying attention. But it's important to note what was going on during that time. So if you need to be a fan of one Chinese leader besides Deng Xiaoping, it's Zhu Rongji. Zhu Rongji was an amazing technocrat. He was an incredible figure in this entire trajectory of what actually happened. And the disaster is that he was followed by a disastrous regime. So from 92 to 2002, they set up so much infrastructure and so much, and it's interesting because you will never have heard Zhu Rongji talk about democracy. But Zhu Rongji was a closet Democrat, to be sure, because he actually used arguments about passing laws that were in the best interest of China's economic position, but they were also pregnant with a lot of institutional infrastructure that we would want to see in that kind of system. And so when you talk to lawyers and talk to business people, late 90s, early 2000s, people were feeling pretty good about how things were moving away from corruption, moving away from bribery. There was a much stronger infrastructural momentum in place, if you will. What happened after that was terrible. Now, it was terrible for two reasons. One is that Hu Jintao and Wen Jiabao are just weak, and they just didn't deliver on anything that they that was sort of already set in motion. But the second is an important thing to know about China, which is that China is a much more decentralized place than most people realize. It is, in my view, radically decentralized. We always think of the strong state and the government's recalcitrance at really carrying out the issues that we want, whether they're in trade negotiations or anything else that they promise. But the interesting thing about China is that the provinces, especially over the last decade, regained so much power. So when we talk about retrenchment, there has been a retrenchment process, but it's sort of been a spinning out of control process for the central government, in my view. Basically, what has happened is that so many of the powerful provinces, and under the guidance of the provincial SASECs, the State-Owned Asset Supervision and Administration Commission, have basically taken back a lot of the control over these SOEs and then started this corrupt process of putting people in place that would be able to line their own pockets. But it's the decentralization that's the problem. It's not the it's not the retrenchment by the central government, in my opinion. Now that decentralization also has it has a positive and a negative side to it, and I just think it's always important to note that China is a very varied market. So if you're a company that wants to go in China and you're thinking about what your China strategy is, it's not enough to just have a Beijing, Shanghai, Guangzhou strategy. You actually have to really think carefully about the different areas. And there are places in China that are great. They have really good institutional infrastructure. They actually do quite well. The local governments are I think, quite friendly towards rational legal systems. And then there are places that are horrible, and you just shouldn't go do business there. But the point is, I think that that decentralization and the lack of control that the center really has over it make China a very difficult place to read, and it also gives a tremendous amount of confusion to all of these questions about trade and all of the questions about the types of relationships. So some markets in China are going to be very, very protectionist and very, very anti-foreign firms and very, very closed, and some are not. And so I just think it's an important thing. There's an additional issue from my perspective that in this country I think we need to be careful about, which is that when we talk about reform and liberalization, of course I'm a capitalist and all for the opening up of markets, but I think we often get caught in this country in a very tired, caricatured debate about states versus markets. State-owned enterprises are not the enemy here. Lack of competition is the enemy. Right? We even know in our own economy there are plenty of organizations that are not state-owned companies that have done very poorly because they have oligopolistic structures around the markets. Right? And so there are plenty of companies in China that are state-owned that actually are very effective. There are plenty of dynamic states. If you look at the local government in Suzhou and the Suzhou Industrial Park Commission, it is one of the most interesting economic projects I have ever studied because it is such an interesting dynamic state that is geared towards competition, but also geared towards strategic planning. And that's actually, I think, one of the things that's really important about China that it puts on the table is how important it is to have industrial policy, how important it is to have planning, how important it is to have a state that invests in industries for the long-term future. And so I think that there's an important thing to think about there and for us to be careful about in terms of how we caricature China. Now, all of that being said, I'm cautiously optimistic because I actually think that we're starting to see good things from the new regime. But again, it's still too early to really understand. And Xi Jinping, to be honest, I mean, I think he's done some very interesting things that look like he's not a captured party and that he's independent and going to do his own thing. But he also is doing things that are making some of the young economic elite in China very, very nervous. And in particular, this is part of the sort of entrepreneurship class that he's just very hard to read. He's really a wild card at this point. And so hopefully we'll continue to see them coming to the table and actually doing the things that we want them to do in terms of bilateral negotiations and such. But it's hard to tell at this moment. Now, I just want to close by saying one thing that I think it's also important to remember in these discussions, and that is that trade is a two-way street. Right now, we tend to think about trade as how closed or relatively closed or open China's markets are for us. But we are not perfect in this area. We have done our share of blocking investments in China. Now, it's always said that it's for good reasons, and there are things behind the scenes that people who are part of CFIUS can't tell you. But to my mind, there have been a number of cases that really have politicized the relationship between us and China that come from our side. And so it's, I think, a really important thing to just be clear that both of us have work to do in this area. So I would not just say that it's the opening of the markets. Now, I have in the past been critical of some of the decisions that CFIUS has made, but there is an additional issue here that I think is really important, which is that it's not just the question of political processes that are blocking investment from China. Remember, China is sitting on $3 trillion of foreign exchange reserves. Like, we need that money to come back here. It's very, very important in terms of the flow of resources that money is not invested elsewhere. It should be invested in the United States because we've sent that capital out over the course of the last 30 years. The problem, though, is that there are some politicized questions that have really soured investment, but there are also, there's just a radical institutional mismatch, which is very interesting. So if you did work on helping companies get into China in the 80s and 90s, you saw it from our end going there, and today you see it coming this way. I've just seen too many major Chinese investors that are very, very having a very difficult time in this particular market. The most interesting one is, of course, Wang Jianlin, who's the head of the Wanda Group. But there are a number of those kinds of groups that have just, they're not running into political walls, they're just running into difficulties in understanding how the markets actually open up here. And so I do think that we just need to continue to think about the flow of resources that go both ways on the trade side. And I'll just close there.
Thank you. That was a wonderful overview, and I'm going to now abuse my prerogative as moderator and ask the first question. So I have a keen interest in the service sector, and the official line in China when I visited there is that they're very keen to raise the efficiency and competitiveness of their service sector, and was struck in a meeting with the deputy director general of the WTO a couple months ago when he said that, I think his words were, he would not be surprised if China tried to join the International Services Agreement negotiations. And I was in Geneva over the summer and met with some of the services people, and they said they would be surprised if they didn't. So I'm curious to the assembled China experts here whether you see evidence of that kind of appetite among Chinese policymakers to join what is supposed to be a very high quality undertaking by people who are very ambitious about allowing services access. So, and I think this spills over into the bit, so I don't want to put anyone on the spot, but would be curious to hear what everyone thinks on that. Thank you. And then we'll open it up.
China's decision to take on in sort of the best international practice style BIT negotiation, I think, indicates a substantial change in China's attitude towards what it's going to be doing regarding investment. Its services sector is also an area where China's economic gurus have indicated they really need to work hard on increasing the amount of GDP that's represented by the services sector in China. So that has led folks to be very interested in watching how China moves in services, particularly given that we have major comparative advantages in services from our sectors. So questions about financial services, questions about logistics services, questions about telecommunication services, questions about professional services. It goes really across the board where we could really help. But I will have to say that China's deeds so far have not indicated that China is moving towards an assertive or forward-leaning posture vis-a-vis reducing investment barriers to services as a kind of top priority. We will have to see what happens in the Shanghai Free Trade Zone. You know, they're saying they're going to do it on a negative list approach, which now you understand since Daniel has explained that to you. But one of the areas that they have been rumored to have on the negative list, i.e., a possible industry that would not be included in Shanghai, is telecommunications. So, you know, you look at these areas with lots of, I mean, telecommunications isn't a monopoly industry, but it's sort of a triopoly. That's probably not an economic term, but I'll use it anyway. You know, so there are three major Chinese companies that dominate that sector, and lots of really entrenched problems for folks who want to get into that space. So it's a little curious to me for them to be, if this is happening, for there to be the feelers out about TISA. Now, having said that, in some ways, it would be consistent with the narrative that says the BIT is a really important push for China, if that's their view. And so it's possible that some are thinking that TISA would also be an important push. If we now look, though, to the WTO setting overall, and where China is in that setting, that's also a mixed signal kind of a situation. If you look, for example, at where China is on ITA, you know, this International Technology Agreement, where China is one of the major exporters in the world of international technology products, and yet China's position seems to be very far out of line with all the rest of the folks that are negotiating the ITA agreement right now, in the sense that they are setting up many in their offer, you know, no, we won't do this, no, we won't do this, far beyond what any other participant is doing. So that, in this mixed signal kind of thing, you have the bit on the one side, you have sort of the ITA on the other, and you have where, so far, they've headed on services liberalization inside their market. So I'd say the jury is out.
If I can add to the mixed signals on this one, I believe it was 2011 when Hu Jintao was here that the president's signed a statement, and China announced as part of its outcomes of the bilateral with Obama that they would be significantly opening the services market. Later that year, China released its most recent version of the catalog guiding foreign investment, which lists that 100 list of restrictions that I mentioned earlier. And there were virtually no changes to the services sector. And in fact, in some areas, there was retrenchment in some of the areas. I think Claire's absolutely right. From a purely economic sense, it is in China's interest to open the services market. And based on China's own experience, the model that they use for opening their manufacturing sector, where they opened it up very widely to foreign companies, I think should be a good model to show that you actually can create the one thing you want the market to create, which is strong companies by allowing more competition, rather than thinking that you're going to get stronger companies by somehow carving out and protecting companies in that sector. But we'll have to see where they go on this. And regardless of whether it's done through a multilateral outlet or through a unilateral outlet or a bilateral outlet, if the outcome is that they significantly open that services sector to companies, I think China benefits from it, and certainly foreign companies in the market do.
Great. Yes, Welby Langer for Ways and Means. Guthrie mentioned that trade investment are a two-way street, criticized CFIUS and mentioned the importance of getting capital flow back from China into the United States. And Bahar mentioned that one of the motivations for China making this step toward pre-establishment negative list is the sort of going out policy of Chinese investors abroad and it changing their perspective. So can you discuss that a little bit more? What is the connection between China taking a greater role as an outbound investor and its likelihood of liberalizing? And in particular, is it a particularly strong effect to the extent that it's into the United States?
Thank you, Welby. A couple of comments on that. And obviously, that comes with the any comment in response to your question, I think, comes with the caveat that we can only speculate about their government's motivations. These are complicated decisions. Different decision makers may have different motivations. There may be no single factor. But I think it is significant that in the, two different dynamics. First of all, I think if you look at the development of China's investment treaties, once again, as an example, in the last 10 years or so, publicly available documents, you can see the significant changes that were made. And there was a clear decision to move from an approach that had relatively narrower obligations and relatively narrower approaches with respect to dispute settlement toward an approach that was much more supportive of outbound foreign investment, much more meaningful substantive rules, much more openness to investor state type arbitration. And there, I think, by and large, those types of changes in approach most likely were motivated mainly by the interest in protecting the significantly increasing outbound Chinese investment. What you see now, I think, on the one hand, is, as articulated by Chinese officials, you know, following SNED, is a continuation of that. Clearly, the idea of the change in approach in the context of the bit with the United States is motivated in part by the interest in outbound investment. I think some of the statements that we saw at that time indicate that that's partly with respect to this negotiation and this market. It clearly also, if successful, could potentially serve as a template for their other negotiations going forward, an approach that could thereby be helpful to their investors in other markets. But again, linked with that in terms of the motivations was very clearly public statements about the fact that the type of discussions that their government will have to enter into with us in the context of the bit, given that we will be covering market access and having a negative list negotiation, clearly are discussions that will involve requests from us to liberalize in key areas. And I think it was significant, the statements that were made, that the decision to move toward this approach is consistent with current thinking about domestic economic reform.
Give your name and affiliation.
I think I'll begin with the caveat that you'll likely conclude when I'm done that I've answered your first question, but not your second. Because I just would hesitate. I would just always be very cautious. I think I've probably gone as far as I can go in speculating and citing public statements that have been made about the motivations on the part of our Chinese colleagues for the decisions that they've made. In terms of the significant progress that's been made, And that phrase in particular, I used because it was a phrase that was directly used by Treasury Secretary Liu. I used the phrase significant breakthrough and paralleled language used by U.S. Trade Representative Froman in the context of the joint statement that was made following the Strategic and Economic Dialogue meeting in July of this year. Okay. Thank you for clarifying that. Maybe you misunderstood the comments that I made then, because the significant progress that I was citing today is the progress that was made at that time. Okay. Thank you for interrupting and not causing me to go backtrack on that.
The question I have for you is, you've mentioned great benefits to American enterprises as well as China, but what is China afraid of? If there are so many benefits, why aren't they opening up? Why aren't they moving forward? Is it political, or is there some other reason?
Thanks for leaving me.
And, you know, this is also just speculation. So, I mean, China is in a very precarious situation right now. So, actually, one thing to remember and understand about China is that this is not a unified authoritarian system. Like, there is a faction within the Communist Party that are liberal reformers, and then there are hardliners who are authoritarian autocrats. And now, it looked like post Tiananmen that was done. You know, Zhao Ziyang was put under house arrest for the rest of his life, and it was over. But I think what happened is the reform movement got a lot smarter. And so, like, Zhu Rongji pushed reform in his agenda and didn't talk a lot about it. It was unclear where Hu Jintao and Wen Jiabao were. And now I think that there's a lot of speculation on who Xi Jinping and Li Keqiang are going to be on this front. Now, that being said, I mean, China is a very messy system right now. I mean, it is a lot messier than it was 10 years ago, as I was saying. But it also is one in which you've seen the growth of a middle class that has their own views about where things should go politically. And so I think what they're afraid of is trying to balance, and they're really balancing on the edge of a knife, this question of whether or not they're going to be able to maintain power as a Communist Party and as an authoritarian system, or whether they're going to see another outbreak of some kind of major uprising that is similar to what happened in 1989. And so, you know, they see these things as connected. They see the liberalization of the markets and basically the controlling of corruption as being tied to their authority within the system. And so now some people in the academy would argue that that's sort of Sam Huntington's view of things, and that's old, you know, that's not really exactly how, you know, liberal markets and democracy don't go hand in hand, and there are lots of examples of authoritarian regimes which persist in markets. But remember that most of those places aren't countries of 1.3 billion people, 500 million of whom still live in abject poverty, and with a growing wealth disparity between the two edges of that margin. And so I think that, you know, what they're afraid of is politics. They're afraid of their political stability. Now, there's one other thing, and this kind of goes back to the question of what leverage do we have. You know, Chinese people still live in the history of the embarrassment of the Opium Wars and everything that happened over the course of the 20th century that led up to the rise of Mao. And they like to be treated with respect. They like to be treated as if they are the number two economy in the world, soon to be number one economy in the world in terms of size. And so I actually think Obama did a great thing when he had, you know, these secret meetings with Xi Jinping, and they weren't very secret, but, you know, I mean, there were sort of unscripted meetings with Xi Jinping in California, because I think that those kinds of things actually do matter, and I think that one of China's great fears is that it's not being respected around the world, and they want to sort of rattle the cage a little bit and say that we should be. But those are just speculations. I don't really know.
Yes, there in the
the issues regarding China's decisions to censor the internet, is that what you're talking about? Are issues that cross into the jurisdiction of some of our fellow agencies, such as the State Department, you know, regarding these questions of individual liberties and human rights. So. That dimension of things really is a set of questions that are better addressed to them. With regard to the issue of transparency and the kind of strong institutions that Doug was talking about that are really important in the economic and trade relationship, those are the kinds of issues that we're talking about all the time with China. So we have out of the strategic and economic dialogue a commitment by China to work, even starting this fall, on additional areas of transparency, you know, in their system as it relates to trade, investment, and economic matters. So we are definitely working on that, and we also are working on it in the context of administrative licensing. That may sound very wonky to you, but our business community can tell you that it's extremely important. It's the day-to-day little traps that catch your foot and make it really hard for you to do business. So those would be the dimensions that we would focus on.
From a business community perspective, I will use Claire's cue and say that probably the technology associations will be able to give you a better direct answer on how the most recent campaign is affecting them. In general, obviously technology companies that deal with the free flow of information on the internet are the most directly affected. I have not had an opportunity to talk to them about the most recent campaign.
In general, though, our companies are concerned about ensuring that they are able to function in whatever sector they're working on in a manner that is not only transparent, but based on rule of law. And so instances like this certainly cause most companies, even if they're not in the tech sector, to have some concern about where the direction is going. But I think, at least right now, for most companies, we're probably more in an information gathering stage. So it's probably the best I can give you right now.
Thank you very much for that question. And I guess I can start by answering very generally. I think that the approach that the U.S. government has taken and has tried to develop throughout the BIT program, but particularly in the last 15 years or so, is very clearly based on an understanding that we may, in every agreement that we enter into, potentially face arbitration cases where our government is the respondent. I'm sure you're aware there's a handful of cases where, under the NAFTA, where we have been a respondent. We're fortunate we've won every one of those cases. We've never paid to settle a case. We've never lost a case. But as we think through the approach in our model bit and in every treaty negotiation, those are very important considerations. And in particular, those have led us to be very careful about ensuring the balance that exists, both in the context of the specific rules that we seek to negotiate, and there are several different areas where we've made very significant clarifications in the last number of years to ensure that the rules are clear, don't go too far, can't be interpreted in overbroad ways. Also, with respect to the so-called arbitration procedures, we include a very large number of safeguards in that area. And I think the U.S. has been given credit in many quarters as really being a leader in the last 10 or 15 years in developing safeguards that ensure, for example, that frivolous claims can be quickly dismissed, that they're deterred by potential awards of attorney's fees against claimant companies that seek to abuse the process, that there are opportunities for transparency, for public participation, for amicus curiae, or so-called friend of the court submissions, that the governments have opportunities to issue binding interpretations of the awards. And so there are other examples, if there were more time, that I could describe, but I think that certainly that's a consideration that's been part of our thinking with every negotiation that we've undertaken, and also with the general approach that we take in our model treaty text.
How long do you think the negotiations might take, if you're a hazard, I guess? And then I guess the second question I would have, the other you referred to Smithfield. That was a recent high-profile case in which the Chinese investment was approved. And I wonder, do you see that as sending, and this is for anybody who wants to answer, do you see that as sending a positive signal to China that their investments will be welcome?
On your first question, we are still at an early stage in the BIT talks. These types of negotiations sometimes move very quickly, sometimes they move less quickly. And certainly I think between these two economies, we've always understood that we would in undertaking the negotiation that it would be a negotiation of significant length and significant complexity. On the second question that you asked, I think I'll defer to other colleagues who may want to take the lead in responding.
I'll take on the Smithfield side of it. I will say that I was very pleased that Bacon is building bridges between the United States and China. We felt very strongly from the beginning that this was an issue where, at best, there were limited national security implications. Selling pork products from the United States to China, a Chinese company who had committed at the outset to maintain not only the full U.S. employment level, but to maintain U.S. standards, and who, under U.S. law, would still be required to meet the exact same food safety standards that Smithfield did when it was an American-owned company. There just simply was no national security implication there. So we were very pleased with the outcome of it. I hope it does send a positive signal. I mean, the reality is when you talk to potential Chinese investors or even existing Chinese investors in the U.S., they do believe that the system is stacked against them. That is partly based on a little bit of lack of information. Not every investment in the United States requires CFIUS approval, and that's just a fundamental difference between our system and China's system, that you don't have to get government approval for everything. But certainly, a case where we are not talking about something that is next to a naval facility or something that involves an already restricted sector in the United States, like telecommunications, we have a really wide and diverse economy. There are plenty of areas where foreign investment should be welcomed in this country, both from China and from any other country in the world. And I hope that this gives them a great deal of confidence to come and create more jobs here.
I want to echo what Erin said, but maybe even amplify it a little bit, because it is so clear from conversations I've had, from whether it's with a couple of months ago, I was in a conversation with Gao Xiqing, who's the head of CIC, and you know, they watch these signals so closely these things have major symbolic implications. And so I was quite nervous that this wasn't going to come out the right way, and I think it did come out the right way. I completely agree with Erin that there's nothing to be worried about here, and I think that they've made the right kinds of commitments. And you know, what I hope is that where it's appropriate, that we need to be guarded and careful, we are, and where it's not, and this one was a case that I think came out exactly the right way. And I do believe it's not just the people, the amount of money that's at CIC. There's a lot of companies in China that are at the $1 to $5 billion range that are looking to go global, that don't really know how, and they could help us create jobs very effectively. And so there's been a lot of those conversations that I've heard even just since the Smithfield deal. And so I think it's a very positive thing in my view.
Here in the back, yeah. Captain Morgan here with Navy Liaison. I was recently in a congressional delegation to Southeast Asia. And one issue that kept popping up was the South China Sea issue and the ASEAN countries. While this is not so much of an investment or trade question, but the issue there is, and this is the U.S. position, to maintain the sea lanes of communication for commerce and trade to take place. How do you see that issue affecting, you know, investments and trade in that area of the world?
I can give my standard answer. We are a bilaterally focused organization, so I'll tell you that in general we hope this gets resolved peacefully, but this really is a discussion that's beyond what our members are talking to us about, so unfortunately I don't have a good answer for you.
Yes, you're on the front.
It's a little bit more tied to business. In regard to the policy of the Hu Jintao administration focusing more on military-civilian integration, which has been kind of transformed in the Xi Jinping administration, is even more tightly focused on this kind of military-civilian integration where you're taking, you know, industries that produce civilian products see the emergence of these kinds of industries as potentially harmful in terms of getting this bilateral investment treaty off the ground, or is it smaller scale and not something that's really concerning at this point?
Now we're all looking this way.
I'm not sure that I'm really in a position to comment on the specific issue that you're describing or its relation to the challenges or potential success of an investment treaty. I do think that, and as I mentioned earlier, you know, negotiating an investment treaty will have, there are a lot of significant challenges that our two sides will face in order to try to successfully move forward in the negotiation, and any sectors that are closed off, sectors that are treated in ways that involve discrimination or that involve other types of significant market obstacles do potentially make the negotiation harder. But I wouldn't want to go further than that and comment on the specific example that you're raising.
Meredith?
Sure. We are not going to be able to get all the sectors, but based on news reports, we know that a variety of sectors have been targeted by investigations by the National Development Reform Commission in China. NDRC is the modern incarnation of the state planners in China, for those of you who don't follow all the acronyms. They have jurisdiction over pricing issues underneath China's antitrust rules, the anti-monopoly law. So MOFCOM controls one aspect on mergers and acquisitions, and NDRC covers pricing. To date, we've heard reports of investigations in sectors ranging from infant formula to autos, telecommunications, banking. There's at least two others, which I'm not coming to mind on. Some of those have been including foreign and domestic companies that have been named. The most high profile, either because it's being covered in the Western press, and so that's where they're focused on, or because that's where the Chinese media is focusing, but there has been a great deal of attention on foreign companies being targeted for these. The concern that we have is, in many ways, the anti-monopoly law is still pretty new law in China. This is really the first wave of these, of the extensive level of these kinds of investigations. And at least at first blush, it's very concerning that foreign companies seem to be mentioned more than others. It also seems pretty unlikely that this many sectors could be experiencing illegal pricing in a market. But the best we can do at this point, since it's all based on news reporting of these things, is we've been encouraging the Chinese government that obviously violations of the law are a problem, but any sort of investigation should be based purely on the facts of the cases and not based on politics or nationality.
If I can just add one little fill-up on that. There was a report that really raised eyebrows of a very, of an official from NDRC getting together in a room with the foreign companies and basically saying to them, do not hire lawyers to deal with these situations when we come to you and tell you that we think something is wrong. Don't hire lawyers to defend you, which is someone from the NDRC. So this is obviously would be when we're talking about there sometimes being mixed signals. The that would be a small example of an area where we would and have made it very clear to our Chinese counterparts that that kind of suggestion from a Chinese official is not constructive.
Oh, Doug, you said.
You know, this is another one of these cases where it's really hard. So first of all, this is not to defend anything that's going on in China, because if targeting is happening the way it sounds like it is, you know, we need to take an aggressive stance at it. The Chinese do notice, though, how far the long arm of justice reaches here. In China last year, a lot of people talked about the AUO Optronics case that not that many people know about, but this was about LCD production that that happened in Asia. All of the manufacturing happened in Asia. Eventually those LCD screens made their way into Dell computers, but none of the production was happening here, and none of the, and there were meetings that were industry-wide meetings that were occurring, and we went after them all. Now, most of the companies settled, except for a little company called in Taiwan called AUL Optronics, and when the proprietors came to this country to visit, their one had a daughter and one had a son here, we took their passports and basically kept them here for about 18 months. And, you know, whether or not we should be prosecuting price fixing in that manner in other countries and in other, I don't know the answer, but I just, it is, again, come back to this issue that we are watched as much as we are watching them. And I think that we have the position to really take the right stance in terms of what to do economically, but I worry sometimes about the signals that go out. Just to be clear about one thing, I am not at all making the case that, I mean, there's, it's so clear that preferential treatment happens for state-owned enterprises, and it's a terrible part of China's violation of WTO standards. I mean, it's very clear that that happens, and I, as I said in my comments, I think it's gotten worse over the last decade. My only point was I think we all are locked into a little bit of a simplistic understanding of what state involvement in economies means. So you mentioned regulation. There's also things like policy that are aggressive growth policies that kind of lead to things like, I mean, that an energy policy or an industrial policy would undergird. But the interesting thing about China that I think is not to be missed is that there is a in some cases, actually a very healthy dynamic relationship between local entrepreneurial governments and sort of a what I think of in some cases as a very creative way for states to be involved in markets. So I mentioned the Suzhou Industrial Park Commission, which is officially a government entity, but a couple of years ago it was involved in enough things that were going on in sort of dynamic development that it went listed on the Singaporean Stock Exchange. And so those kinds of things actually create dynamics in which the state doesn't just have incentives that are about, you know, being aligned with protectionism, but actually they have incentives that are about local state development. And so there are a number of examples like that in China, and I just worry that we think a little too simplistically about it in this country.
Now, I'll add in just specifically, we poll our members every year on what their business operations look like in China and what they're dealing with there. When we ask about state-owned enterprises versus other companies, most companies tell us in order that their competitors in China are actually other foreign companies, then Chinese domestically privately owned companies, and then Chinese state-owned enterprises. Now, all of them, obviously you compete with all three, and so most of them are competing with all three of them. But we then always ask them the follow-up question. So are your Chinese competitors, dividing up SOE and private, getting benefits that you don't have access to? The answer in general is yes, although with the caveat that probably more of them can't prove that they're getting benefits, but are pretty sure that they are. And that's universal for both state-owned enterprises and private companies. And the nature of the benefits that they mostly say that they're getting are preferential access to financing, so loans that are either extremely low interest rate or no payback loans. Preferential access to licenses, so their Chinese competitors get approved more quickly for business expansion or for new products or for even opening an office in China, and preferential access to tax incentives in China. I mean, again, every one of these things are ones that I think probably Doug is right. Probably SOEs have a little more advantage in doing it. But keep in mind, some of the largest Chinese companies that are competitive internationally are not state-owned enterprise. Huawei, not an SOE. Lambda, I think only is private as well. It may only have some government investment. So our concern from the beginning on any of these issues is really the ultimate issue that we have here is where there are things that are specific to state-owned enterprises, they should be addressed. But in general, what our companies are experiencing on the ground is a differential treatment between what your nationality is. Are you Chinese or are you not Chinese? And that seems to be a significant factor in what kind of benefits you're getting, even if the depth chart of how much benefits you're getting might vary between the Chinese companies.
Great. Sorry, we're gonna a quick follow-up.
The short answer is yes. I mean, there are a number of different ways in which a bit addresses the issue of SOEs and any other issue relating to the need to level the playing field.
Right. So please join me in thanking what I think was a